dreamed I went to heaven, and you were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold, beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing, and someone called your name. We turned and saw this young man, and he was smiling as he came. And he said, friend, you may not know me now. And then he said, but wait. You used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. And every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Then another man stood before you and said, remember the time a missionary came to your church. His pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave, and that's why I'm here today. Thank you for giving to the Lord. Changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. One by one they came, far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices made, unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaimed. And I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry. I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. For I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so so glad you came.
Thank you. that come as a result of that. But at the same time, God's judgment comes to bring us back to Him so that we might understand the joy of living in His presence and we might make that choice for our life, teaching us that the real blessing of life is not doing what we want, but doing what God wants for each one of us. Micah's people needed to learn that, and I believe God's people in the 21st century need to learn that too. At least many of them do, because they've drifted away from the church and they've drifted away from the things of God, and they've drifted away from the faithfulness and the standards of morality and holiness that God's Word establishes for us, and chosen to adopt something that's less than that. Well, it's easy to see these parallels between our day and the day in which Micah lived. And, you know, we could look at this and we could become very pessimistic about it all, and we could say, well, you know what we're seeing, Pastor, is just a kind of a sign of the times. It's just kind of the way the world is going. And if you read in prophecy, you could say the world is going to turn in that direction, and we should expect that. We should anticipate that. Well, I'm not going to be so pessimistic as to say that. What I'm going to say is the God that I serve is powerful and mighty and still able to save and still able to change lives and still able to bring hope to the hopeless and still able to bring us to a place where we can experience the joy of His presence. So I believe today each one of us should resolve to make it known to everyone, according to what this passage of Scripture says, that God still pardons sin and that the transgression of our life can still be swept away by His saving grace and the shed blood of His Son, and that God will not stay angry forever but delights in showing mercy. Saying those things to a world that is in desperate need helps them to see that there's an opportunity to find something in Christ that they just can't find anywhere else. You see, I'm here to tell you this morning that life will not always be as it is now. And I'm not just talking about heaven when we die and being able to be with Him there. But I believe that in this world, in America of today, God's glory can be seen. God's glory can't be hidden unless we're the ones who hide it. But if we'll open up our lives and speak with boldness and joy and just excitement about what God has done in our life, His glory will shine through each one of us and we'll be able to see the power of His presence. I want you to look back with me at your Bibles, if you would, to verse 7 one more time. There's something here that I want to say. This is a statement in my mind that I think should burn into the hearts of each one of us, and we should never, ever forget this. Notice what he says. I watch in hope for the Lord. Burn that in your mind. I watch in hope for the Lord. Let that be the standard that you live by. You know what? I'm going out into this world and there's all kinds of struggle and there's all kinds of heartache and there's all kinds of disappointment. There's all kinds of pain that we see, poverty and war and distress everywhere we look. But I watch in hope for the Lord. Because God has something better for us. There's so much uncertainty in this world today. And yet, with no absolutes before us, there is one that we can always rely upon. And that's certainly the presence of God. And He will never, ever, listen friends, He will never disappoint us. Putting your hope in Him is always going to be the right thing. Now, even in the bleakness of this situation that Micah was facing, I think he understood that there was a day of hope that was coming and that was real for them. And he wouldn't allow himself to become so short-sighted as to think that things could never change, that things are always going to be like they are, or they're going to get even worse than they are today. He couldn't allow himself to think that way. He trusted in a different reality, and the reality is that God is still on His throne. Amen? God is still exalted in the lives of His people when they choose to follow Him. And God can still make a difference, not only for an individual, but for entire nations. And I believe that we need to be praying desperately for a revival to come to our church, to our community, to our nation, to our world, so that God would be lifted up, glorified, honored. And so that revival would start in each one of us as we feel the power of the Holy Spirit just well up within us. And we move out with an excitement we haven't felt in a long time. We move into this world with a joy and a hope that can only come from Jesus and His presence in our life. And that we make that testimony of His glory known to this world. You know, we might have moments in our life when we'd look around and we'd say, man, I tell you what, I don't understand what's going on in our world today. And I have some of those moments. I really do. I sometimes wonder how in the world God's going to bring good from a bad situation. I've struggled with that in my life at times. But when we're able to fully give ourselves to the Lord and fully see what God is doing, that He's in control no matter what we think, we're able to find a greater joy than we ever thought possible before. And one of the things, I don't know, maybe I'm just different than everybody else, but one of the things that I have learned the hard way is that God doesn't always make the pain of the present go away. Sometimes He just allows us to endure that pain in His presence so that we can bring greater glory to Him. You know, I look around and I see the news and I read the papers and I see all of the things that are on the internet and I recognize that this world is racked by evil. It is. And evil is always going to be working to try to destroy whatever good they see in front of them. And that includes God's purposes through His people. Evil is going to be working in this world to try to destroy the testimony of the church. Evil is going to be working in this world to try to stop you from lifting up Christ in your life on a daily basis. But listen, despite all that the forces of evil are doing in this world, we can rejoice. We can find reason for thanksgiving because the hope that we have in Christ is not lessened. We're watching for Christ. We're waiting for Him to show up, and He's going to show up in our lives individually. And one day, I don't know when that day is going to come, the sky is going to split wide open, and the trumpet of God will sound, and there's going to be Jesus Christ, the Lord God of all of earth, and He's going to be calling the saints home to the reward that they have waiting for them. And He's going to bring a time to this world that's going to be different than anything they've ever seen before. There's going to be a time of judgment, certainly, but it's going to be ended with a time of peace and prosperity like this world has ever known. We can rejoice in the hope that we have in Christ. In 1 Peter, the apostle wrote that God in His great mercy has given to us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. Now I want you to look at your Bibles or look on the screen and notice the emphasis on the word living hope. It's one that grows stronger and stronger and more powerful with each passing day. This is not a some kind of a fleeting desire that maybe it will happen. This is the living hope that we have in Jesus Christ. This is a reality for us. This is how we live. I love the way the New Living Translation, some of you read after that, I love the way that it offers this verse. It says, now we live with great expectations. Man, isn't that wonderful? To think about that. The expectations that I have are not the things that we see around here, but the things that we look towards and the heavens for. The things that we see in God. Our hope is in the Lord God who has changed everything for us, moved us away from the despair of the old life and made everything brand new for us. Knowing that, could there be a better time for any one of us just to lift our voice in testimony and thanksgiving for the great things that God has done for us, for the great hope that we have in Christ Jesus? It was to the Corinthian church that Paul reminded them how powerfully God works. Let me read to you some of what he said. He said, because we have hope in Christ is why we never give up. I'm going to say that again. Because we have hope in Christ, we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed day after day. And then he went on to say, the present troubles that are small and won't last very long, yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them all and will last forever. And then he offered this challenge, and this is what I want to offer to you this morning. I want you to accept this challenge and realize this, the joy that we have. He says, don't look at the troubles that we can see now. Rather, fix your gaze on the things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things that we cannot see will last forever. Man, I tell you what, fix your eyes on the things we cannot see. Look at Jesus. Look at the hope that he has. I mean, there's reason for excitement. There's reason for thanksgiving. There's reason for joy. Just because I'm looking at Jesus, the one who will never leave me, the one who will never forsake me, the one who is always there for me. We have an inheritance, according to what these verses say, that cannot be touched by death. It will not be stained by evil. It won't fade over time. It is death-proof. It is sin-proof. It is age-proof. It is fail-proof because God in heaven guards it for each one of us. So what we have placed our hope in, what we rejoice in this morning, what we can lift our voices in thanksgiving for this morning is that nothing in heaven, nothing in earth, nothing in all of the forces of evil, all the realms of evil of this world can ever undermine the future inheritance that God has prepared for those that love him. Nothing can stop that from happening. Celebrate that this morning. Let that be your joy. And then we look at this and we think, well, this is our reality. Man, I'm living with hope. I have a hope in Jesus that transcends the affairs of this world. I don't have to worry about anything. Man, I got Jesus on my side. But you know, there are a lot of people I know that don't have that hope. There's a lot of people you know that don't have that hope. And you know, we look around at the consequences of this sin-broken world and we see where people are in distress everywhere. I mean, there's a sadness that just seems to overwhelm them. There's a sense of despair that just they can't seem to shake. It doesn't really matter how much they have. It doesn't matter how much they think they're in control in this moment. There's something that they're headed toward, a future that they just can't put their finger on. And they think, this is not, something's not right there. You just sense that in all of these people. And in their lives, you may not realize it, but you might be one of the most important people for them because you have hope. You have a message that you can share. You have a word of hope that can make a difference in their life. You can make a difference because in their desperation, you can share with them the opportunity to experience the one that gives you hope. You know, maybe you remember what it was like when you were living like they're living now. Without hope, without God, without any real direction, without any purpose, trying to find fulfillment and joy in the things that could never provide them. What a terrible way to live. And yet that's the way so many people in our world are living today. And perhaps you might also remember the joy that came to your life on the moment that you realized that it doesn't have to be that way. And you invited Jesus Christ to come into your life, to be your Savior, to be your Lord, and he changed everything for you. And from that moment on, all the old things that used to bind you and keep you in that despair and keep you in that hopelessness no longer had any power because your focus is on Jesus. You're looking to Jesus, the author of hope, the one who has given you new life, and you've trusted him. Perhaps you remember that with joy and just a smile comes to your heart and to your face when you think about those things. But I want to challenge you. Your willingness to share that experience can become an invaluable aid to somebody else's faith. It can be one of those moments where you become a stepping stone that helps them come to Jesus. Now think about this. There are people that you say you love in your life right now. Family members, friends, neighbors, coworkers, whoever, people that are living real lives of desperation, and God has placed them in your life, placed them before you, given you an opportunity to influence them so that you can testify of hope, of life, of eternity to every one of them. Now, you don't need to know some fancy witnessing plan. You just need to have a story, and you have one, your story. Share it. Let people see that. Let it be real to God for each one of them. You know, I have a feeling, and I don't know, I'm not always right about stuff, but I have this feeling that Thanksgiving is going to take a whole new meaning for you when you realize that I have the joy of making a difference in someone's life. Not because I saved them, but because in some small way I was able to take them and point them to Jesus. Point them to the Savior and let Him do what only He could do in their lives. You know, here's the thing. In our world, the forces that are at work in this world want you to be ashamed of your story. They want you to be silent. They're doing everything in their power to keep you from saying and doing the things that I just mentioned. They don't want you to tell about what Jesus has done in your life. They don't want you to do those things because they know, more so perhaps even than we do, that when Jesus is lifted up, He still draws people unto Him and He still saves. And so they don't want you to be lifting up Jesus. And so they've made it almost feel like, well, we're intrusive when we talk of Jesus. We're saying things that we shouldn't say. We're doing things that we shouldn't do when we talk about Jesus. Well, friends, let's don't buy into that argument. You know, some might say, well, we're not being politically correct. Well, praise God. In this world of politics, we need to be everything but what they're doing, it seems to me like. That's a whole nother story. I heard a story one time about this boy, fourth grade. And he received an assignment from his teacher. And his teacher said, what I want you to do is I want you to write just a short little essay about the pilgrims at Thanksgiving, what you know about the pilgrims and what happened and what they did and why they did it. And from all of the things that we've been talking about in our lesson, I want you to be thinking about that, and I want you to just write, you know, a paragraph or so that talks about the pilgrims. And this little boy, who, fourth grader, who had felt and heard so much about being, make sure you say it right and don't offend anybody with your statements, he said this. I'll read it to you. The pilgrims came here seeking freedom from you know what. When they landed, they gave thanks to you know who. And because of them, we can worship on Sunday, you know where. Afraid to say what was really in his heart. Listen, this is an upside down world. I know that it is. I know there are all kinds of problems, but I know whom I put my trust in. His name is Jesus, and I'm not ashamed to say his name. And I don't think any one of us should be ashamed to say his name in this world. I know what his message for mankind is. His message is one of hope, and some people will look at it and say, all it is about condemnation. You're a sinner before God. But it doesn't stop there. It says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. God wants everyone to have that gift. God wants everyone to experience that joy. God wants everyone to walk after that purpose. Yes, we're sinners, and we need to acknowledge that. We all know that. We accept that reality. But we can have hope because there's someone who died in our place and lives again. And when we put our faith in Him, though our sins be as scarlet, they can be as white as snow. I say that again and again because I think that's an important message that we need to be sharing. And I know where my future is. My future is held in the hands of God. And you know what? My Bible taught me that Jesus, in His infinite love for me, through the Father, has reached down into my life and He's wrapped His hands around me. And there is no one big enough to make my Father let go of me. He loves me that much. And whether I live in this flesh another day or another 30 years, I don't know how long it's going to be, but one of these days when I leave this flesh, and people gather around and they talk about my life and they talk about all the things I did or didn't do or should have, shouldn't have done, what all those kinds of things. I'm not going to worry about that. And I don't want y'all to worry about it either, because you know something, I'm going to be in heaven and I'm going to be rejoicing around the throne of God. God's made me that promise. To be absent from this flesh is to be present with Him, and I'm longing for that day. I'm looking forward to that. You see, I am grateful beyond measure that I have been forgiven, that I have been granted new life, that I have hope. And just like Paul wrote to Timothy so long ago, I can say, I know whom I have believed. And I am convinced that He is able to guard that which I've entrusted to Him against that day. Friend, can you say that this morning? I mean, the greatest joy of Thanksgiving is not the feast, it's the author of the feast. The greatest joy in Thanksgiving is not just being able to say, oh my, look at the abundance of my life that I have gathered up to me, but the abundant blessing that God has poured into our lives. Look at your life right now. Number one, I'll ask you this. Do you know Jesus? Do you know Him to be a Savior and Lord in your life? Has there been a moment in time when you humbled yourself and came before Him and said, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know there's nothing in myself that I can do to overcome that sin. Come into my heart, come into my life, be my Savior, be my Lord, and allowing Him to do what only He can do in your life. If you've done that, you're a Christian. You're walking in fellowship and faith with the Lord. At least that's what God's intent is. But as you look at your life today, do you honestly feel like there's a joy in that fellowship? Do you honestly feel like there's just an excitement about walking day after day with Jesus and experiencing the power of His grace and mercy in your life just flooding through you and in your life and out into other people's lives as well? And if you can't feel that this morning, maybe today you need to come and rededicate your life to Jesus and say, you know, I don't want the world to encroach. I want Jesus to have full sway. Man, take hold of my life. I offer it to you. Maybe this morning you can't remember the last time that you have opened your mouth and gave a verbal testimony of your life and what Christ has done for you and shared that with a loved one, shared that with a friend, shared that with a neighbor, maybe even shared it with a complete stranger. I don't know, just whenever the opportunity presented itself. You just can't remember the last time you did that. You know one of the greatest tragedies of the world today? It's not the pandemic. It's the silence of God's people. We can't be silent anymore. The world is in too great a need. We're the difference makers for Jesus. You and I are His ambassadors to this world. Speak His truth. In a moment, we're going to have an invitation time. We're going to sing this song, I'd Rather Have Jesus. And I hope that you really mean that. But when we sing that song, I'm going to invite you, if you're here this morning and you need to know Jesus, you recognize you're not walking after Him and you want to rededicate your life, or maybe you just want to come and pray that God would give you a testimony, I'm going to invite you to come. And I'll be waiting here at the front. I'll be happy to pray with you. You can make this an altar prayer if you want to do that. However God leads you. But don't you dare leave this place until you've done that business with God, because the decision that you make might encourage someone else to make a decision as well. Oh, friend, what's God asking of you this morning? So much to be thankful for. But it begins and ends with Jesus. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for all that You do in our life, all that You have done in our life, and all that You, the blessing that You continue to pour into us. Lord, You present opportunity after opportunity for us to just make a difference in this world for You. And I would pray right now, God, that in these next moments, each one of us will take a time to look at our heart and our life. And no matter where we are, what station we're at in life, what position we have in this church, none of those things are going to matter. What matters, Lord, is are You really the King in our life right now? Maybe there's somebody here, God, who doesn't know You, and I pray that the convicting spirit will just come upon them and help them to see that it's not about church membership and it's not about a baptism somewhere. It's about a faith relationship with You. And I pray, dear God, that they'll know they have that. They can point to a moment in time when they have received You as Jesus Christ, Savior, Lord in their life, because they humbled themselves and called on Your name. Lord, help us to walk after You. Help us to walk in faithfulness and devotion to You. Help us, Lord, to be the people that You want us to be in all of these areas of life. And help us, God, to open our mouth and share the testimony of what You've done. Share our story of faith with others so they might have an opportunity to experience You as well. Lord, work in us today. We offer our lives, we offer our all to You. Have Your way with us, and we'll thank You and praise You for what You're going to do. May Your name be glorified today. Amen. Stand with me as we sing, "You Make Your Decision for Christ." Couple of announcements that I'd like to share with you before we conclude our services this morning. And first of all, let me just say, it might have been that God said something to you, and you know, it's hard for us sometimes to make that very first step that we need to take to find our way back to God, and sometimes it's even hard in the church when we're gathered together with God's people to take that first step and say, you know what, I want to go and maybe talk to somebody or whatever. Please, before you leave this place today, if God has been speaking to your heart and maybe there's some need that you have, somebody you need to pray with you or encourage you in some form or fashion, find that person that you have spiritual confidence in and ask them to pray with you. I will be available to anybody after the service if you want to visit. I'd love to take the time to do that just to be an encouragement to you. I think this time of the year, more so than any, we just need that joyful encouragement that can be offered from a brother or sister in Christ. And so let that be something that you choose to do this morning. Now, in the way of announcements, a couple of things real quickly. Number one, today is the day. Today is our drive-through Thanksgiving dinner fellowship. It's going to be exciting, isn't it? I mean, it's different, and I know it's probably not exactly the way we would hope to be able to do this, but this is a great alternative, isn't it? Now, last week, we gave you, in your bulletin and out on the table out there, there were a number of little slips of paper that on the one side that had a menu that you could fill out and say, this is what the dinner that I want, and you needed to make sure you filled out one for every member of your family. You could have done that online, and many of you have, and for that we're grateful. But if you have not yet turned in your meal request, please do so before you leave here today. And if I forgot it at home, and I want to get this taken care of, there's still plenty of them out there on the table. Be sure to stop by and pick those up, okay? They're really important that you do that. And then here's what you do. Between 5 and 5:30 tonight, you just get in the car, drive through, stop. You don't have to get out of the car. You don't have to do anything. Just stop there underneath the drive through at the church, at the entrance here, and someone from our youth group will meet you, and they'll bring the food that you've desired right out to you, and then you can go home and enjoy it. I mean, how good is that? It's like going to, you know, candlelight for free. But the food's going to be better, okay? And so we're really looking forward to it. It's going to be a great time. But this is the really good part, okay? So we're going to feed you physically. And what's that stuff that makes you sleepy? Yeah, that stuff. When that stuff starts to kick in, go get you a cup of coffee, get you a Coke, do something, got a little caffeine, build you back up again, because at 7 o'clock, you want to turn on your computer, your TV, whatever you use to watch our live stream at home. And at 7 o'clock tonight, we're going to have a live stream Thanksgiving service, okay? There's going to be music. I hear there's going to be this young, dynamic speaker that's going to be sharing some thoughts. It's going to be exciting. I said that on Wednesday night, and somebody said, who's young around here? Becky. Oh, so sorry, I wasn't supposed to mention any names. I apologize. But anyway, we're going to have that live stream at 7 o'clock. It's only going to last about 30 minutes, so I think it'll be a real good encouragement for you. So take some time, sit down with your family, and let's just spend some time physically being nourished and spiritually being nourished. I think it'll be a lot of fun, and I hope that you'll join us for that. All right, second thing, and I'm really excited about this. We have in our church someone who is serving our country in the military. And Maddie Roach, okay, we know that she is somewhere. We don't know exactly where somewhere is, but we know she's in the Middle East, right? And so I contacted her mom, and we were just talking a little bit about different things that we might do. And I was thinking, boy, you know, we could do something that we could bless her at Christmas time. That'd be wonderful, wouldn't it? If you've ever served in the military, I'm sure you like to get mail, right? That was a good thing. Well, we've decided to go all out, and I think we can do this, okay? In her, I think it's called a squad. In her squad, there are 14 people, 6 women and 8 men. And we're going to bless all of them. Maddie and all of the rest of them. We're going to send a box of just Christmas care package, if you will, to each one of those people. Now, we have placed a list out on the bulletin board and then right next to my office door of items that we need, okay? Stop by there, take a look at that, and kind of make this mental check and say, okay, these are some things that I can help provide. Remember, we got 14 different airmen that we're going to be providing this for, okay? And so let's make sure that we go overboard. Now, I have to tell you that we are limited on the size of the boxes that we can send. But what's it going to be like on mail? They still do mail call in the service? Is that how they do it? We don't know all these people's names. So you know what we're going to do? We're just going to send them all to Maddie. And on that day, she's going to get 14 boxes. And people are going to say, what on earth? But she knows. She's going to know in advance, you know, these are going to have to be handed out to her friends. But what a way for us just to bless these guys and these gals who are out on the surf. Now, we have to have this done back here to the church by December 13th, okay, in order for us to get that to them in time for Christmas. And so stop by. Let us know how you can help. And, you know, start bringing those things in. We'll put up a display area this week and have it out where everybody can start placing their items. And we'll just gather all of this stuff up. And then on the 14th, we're going to have a, you know, get some people together. We're just going to box everything up and get as much, the boxes that we're using, doesn't matter what they weigh, it just matters how size they are. So we can put as much stuff in as we can possibly get in there and send them off and bless these people who are serving our country. So help us with that if you would, okay? And then one final thing. When you go out of the sanctuary, and this is for the ladies that are here this morning. When you go out of the sanctuary this morning, I want you to look to the left, because on the table over there is a bunch of gifts. And I just don't know exactly where they showed up from, but they're for you. Okay, you go over there, and there's a little name tag on them, and I want you to open it up, find the one that's got your name on it, and then take it with you. It's a secret sister kind of gift for everyone, and so every lady will have one, so make sure that you stop by and get one this morning, and if you don't find one with your name, you let me know, and we'll make sure you get that taken care of, okay? All right, any other announcements that need to be made this morning? The announcements were almost as long as the sermon, weren't they? Linda's over there going, yeah. All right, let's stand together and rejoice as we sing together a song of conclusion as we end our services this morning. God bless you, and I hope you have a very happy Thanksgiving.
Our granddaughter. We're so proud. And she wrote me a letter and she said, Grandma, I go to church every Sunday and I'm being really blessed. She says, but I sure do miss Pastor Dan's preaching. Nobody's that good. Amen. And the people said?
Amen.
All right.
She's living in desperation.
No. Some glad morning, I'll fly away. Sing it out and stomp and clap and hoop and holler. Okay.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you for this glorious day to be in your house, to sing these songs of praise to you, God, to lift your name up with a joyful song. Lord, thank you for your message this morning. Father, just a message to remind us how thankful, God, we are for your blessing in every part of our life, Father. Lord, help us to see that. Help us to rejoice in that. Lord, help us to look around. Look around at the people around us, in our families, in our church family here, Father. Lord, for the way they love us, for the way they encourage us. God, may we go and just, in a way that's social distancingly correctly, but thank each other, God. Thank each other for each of us loving one another with that kind of love that Christ you gave us. Lord, dismiss us now from here, Lord. Dismiss us now to go back home to our families. And God, just celebrating the joy that we had today in spending in the presence, God, of your throne room. God, amen to all this. Amen.